lectures here in World History. Today we're going to continue on with the Greco-Persian Wars. The previous video in this series focused on the Battle of Marathon. 10 years later, another very significant battle is fought between the Greeks and the Persians, and it's called the Battle of Thermopylae. So that's the battle we're going to focus on here today. We still have the same two constructive response questions we're seeking to answer throughout this process. The first one says compare and contrast the Greeks and the Persians. And that's not a question we can just answer from watching this video. It's something that we're working on with several lessons in my course. The second question, though, for sure we'll be able to answer. It says describe what happened and the significance of the Battle of Marathon, Thermopylae, or Salamis. So you get a choice within a choice, but because this video is going to focus on Thermopylae, we're going to be able to use all the information today to answer that question very, very thoroughly. So if you choose to answer that one on the test, you certainly will have all the information needed. Now, remember, there's three battles in this series that we are looking at. They're not the only battles that existed between the Greeks and the Persians, but they're three of the most famous. So we already covered the Battle of Marathon. Today we're going to cover the Battle of Thermopylae. Remember, these are three real battles. They actually happened, whereas the Trojan Wars from the Iliad was more literature written down by Homer, and we do not think that that actually happened. So I want to always make sure that that distinction is drawn here, that these actually happened. So we had talked about how Marathon was just north of Athens. You have to go quite a bit further north to get to Thermopylae. And Thermopylae was a geographic location. If the Persians wanted to march in from the north, they would have had to have gone through Thermopylae, and the Greeks would have known this. But this time, instead of the Athenians doing the fighting, it's going to actually be the Spartans from much further south. So let's start talking about the five W's of the Battle of Thermopylae. So, of course, the Battle of Thermopylae is made famous by the film 300, and there is some things in that movie that are worth using. I show bits and pieces of it in my class. It's based on a graphic novel by Frank Miller, and the filmmakers actually did an outstanding job of remaking that graphic novel, which is a fancy way of saying a comic book, into the movie. I mean, they took direct scenes, direct dialogue. The movie is the closest version of that book that you could possibly make. So if you like graphic novels, this is the way to go. But you have to understand, it's stylized, it's sensationalized, it is not like a truly authentic way to look at this battle. But they do get some pieces right, and that's why I show little bits and pieces of it in my class. If you ever do watch 300, watch it more for entertainment value than anything else. But this is a scene from the film, and I'm going to show you a couple other pictures from scenes from the film as well. So let's start with the who. On the Persian side, they're led by Xerxes. So 10 years earlier, it was Darius who led the Persians against Marathon. But here we have Darius has passed away, and now Xerxes is in charge of the Persians. On the Greek side, they're mostly going to be led by King Leonidas of Sparta. This story is famous by King Leonidas and his 300 Spartans holding off the Persians. That's what's known as the Hot Gates. And again, this is a image right out of the comic book. It's Thermopylae itself is a mountain pass, and these 300 men are going to hold them right here. But there were actually other Greeks at the battle, and the movie really doesn't show that well, but we'll cover that in a little bit. So again, where was this? Well, it's a mountain pass called Thermopylae. They called it the Hot Gates. But if the Persians wanted to move south, you know, Greece is very mountainous, it's very hilly. I've been there, I can attest to that. And so there are some places that it would have been very difficult to, get to. So if you wanted to travel by land from Persia, you would have had to have come from the north and then move south towards Athens. The only place it really allowed for that at the time was this mountain pass called Thermopylae. So if you really wanted to bottleneck the Persians to try to stop them from advancing, this would have been the place to do it. Now, Xerxes in the film is shown as this like 7-foot guy with all these piercings, treated as a god and all these things. And that's, again, sensationalized. What we see on the left is the 300 version. On the right is probably a more accurate depiction of what Xerxes actually looked like. So again, if you watch 300, you'll learn a little bit about history, but be careful to accept all of it as fact, because it really isn't. This is King Leonidas in 300. He's played by Gerard Butler. So we're going to talk a lot about King Leonidas here and his actions moving forward. So when did this occur? Well, it's 480 BC. That's 10 years after the Battle of Marathon. And here again, you can see this is a very, very mountainous country. And so if I'm the Persians and I'm moving from the north down south, the only place that's really going to allow me to even get close to Athens is right through here. So that's why Thermopylae was such a strategic location for the Greeks. They would have known that. Why did this occur? Well, the Persians still wanted to conquer Greece. I mean, that was their goal at Marathon. They are a conquering nation. They want to move west and take on more land, and the Greeks would have been the next country, or next group of people that would have been ripe for conquering. But there's also a revenge factor here. Xerxes wanted revenge from his father's loss at Marathon 10 years earlier. So Xerxes needs to prove himself. Xerxes needs to go in and do what his father never did, and that's conquer the Greeks. So those are our reasons for this particular battle. Now, I've mentioned how the Persians are traveling by land. So remember in the Battle of Marathon, they just sailed across the Aegean. They landed their ships here. But that didn't work out well for them. They lost the Battle of Marathon. So this time, they actually cross over here and go by land. Now, it's a much longer journey, but it gives you some advantages. As you don't have to land ships, you don't have a beach. Beaches can be very difficult to secure and take militarily. So they're moving south, and they're going to move south to Athens, but they have to go through Thermopylae to do that. So what happened? Well, save some room here, because I'm going to walk you through the main points of this battle. So 10,000 Greeks, led by Leonidas, met the Persians at Thermopylae. Again, the movie's going to make you think it's just Leonidas and his 300 men. They meet up with a few other Akkadians in the movie, but they don't really show you the scope of how many truly were there at the beginning. So again, be careful when you watch that film. So the Greeks then led the Persians into that narrow pass. They knew that that was the place to hold them. Problem was, there was another route around it, and only Greek farmers in that area would have known it. And in the movie, the traitor, his name is Ephialtes, and he's kind of ready to fight for the Spartans, and problem is he's disfigured, he's disformed, he can't hold a shield, so King Leonidas basically says, hey, I love your, you know, attitude, but there's no way you could fight for us. And he is rejected and eventually goes over to the Persian side, and he tells the Persians about this alternate route. So the Greek traitor Ephialtes shows the Persians an alternate route to surround the Greeks. So for the first 3 days, the Greeks are holding on, but then they become surrounded, and there's not much they can do. So Leonidas and his 300 Spartans stayed to defend the pass, and I think Leonidas knew every single day that he hung on, every single day that he was able to keep the Persians from advancing was going to be advantageous to everybody below this point, everybody south of Thermopylae. Because while this is going on, they're essentially getting out of town and getting to safety. So Leonidas and his 300 Spartans stayed. All the rest of the Greeks either fled or were killed, and it was just Leonidas and his 300 there at the end. And all of those Spartans and Leonidas himself were killed, dead to the last man. So your instant thought should probably be, well, the Persians win. And they do. I mean, at this particular battle, the winner is clearly the Persians. If the Spartans are all dead and the Persians can move forward, then it's clearly a Persian victory. But I'm going to tell you, there's a silver lining in that loss for the Greeks. So again, just to give you an idea of what we're talking about moving through here, here's the mountain pass, here's where the Spartans held on, but this is the alternate route that the Persians used to get around the Spartans and surround them. The Spartans were hoping that the Persians were never going to know about that, but ultimately the traitor showed them that pass. So who won? It's the Persians. I told you, it has to be the Persians. If they kill everybody there and they can advance, it's definitely a Persian victory. Xerxes moves through and he burns Athens to the ground. He makes it to Athens, and he burns the city down. Now remember, Leonidas was a Spartan, but the ultimate goal for Xerxes was Athens. So he burns Athens to the ground, but he actually regrets this immediately and orders the city to be rebuilt shortly after. Now, we're going to get to the Athenian Golden Age shortly after this, in a couple of days. So Athens doesn't look like the Athens that we think of it today. The Parthenon has not been built. There's not this flourishing of Greek culture. That's going to come next. Athens is still a big deal, but it's not like he burned down the Parthenon and destroyed all these awesome temples. Athens' day, Athens' might is still yet to come. So, but it tells us something about Xerxes, too. If he ordered the city to be burned down, he realized that that was a big mistake and ordered the city to be rebuilt. He's not this ruthless, horrible guy that we maybe have been led to believe he was by Hollywood and the film 300. Now, the significance here, though, this is a big deal. Even though the Spartans were dead, they had held on long enough to allow many others to get to safety. The story says that when Xerxes and the Persians made it to Athens, there wasn't a soul there. The city had been evacuated. So it's not like Xerxes could go in and slaughter and murder all these people. They were all basically out of town and even plotting and preparing for the next battle. So the Spartans allowed that to happen. So yes, it's a loss for the Spartans, but even with a loss, positives can come out of it. So that is the significance of the Battle of Thermopylae. I've been there. There's not much there. It doesn't look anything like you would think it is. The mountain pass is gone. I mean, we're talking 2,500 years of erosion and changes to the environment. All that you can see there is this wall with a statue of Leonidas in the back. So you can kind of see, I did a little one of my spinny selfie videos. But this would have been the ground where the battle took place. So it's like you just kind of pull over with your bus, you get out, you take pictures for about 10 minutes, and that's all that's there. Now, I've also been told that the battle actually took place like 100 feet below where we were standing. Again, with erosion and everything, the battle didn't actually take place right there. It was quite a bit lower. And the water was right up to the edge behind that wall. You can't even see the water where we were standing. So the geography looks very, very different today than it did at the time of this battle. Just another look at the hills. So the mountain pass would have been right through here, but it's pretty wide open today. And there's a pretty important road that goes through there that our bus took. Now, there's just me in front of the statue of Leonidas at the Thermopylae Monument. All right, that brings us to the end. Again, compare and contrast the Greeks and the Persians is a question we've been working on. You get to know a little bit more about the Greeks and the Persians through studying these battles. But the question below is the one we're really most focused on. It says, describe what happened and the significance of the Battle of Marathon, Thermopylae, or Salamis. We now have enough information to answer that on Marathon and Thermopylae. Remember, you're choosing one battle, not all three, to answer that question. And if you want to, we're going to cover one more battle at the Battle of Salamis. You could cover that one too if you felt comfortable. So that should do it for us here today. Hope you learned something. We'll see you next time.